I want to be able to show you guys exactly what is taking place here right now near the new protest camp. This is about 8 miles south of Fort Rice. There's fire at the barricade. Not sure how this fire started, but police are telling them to step back so they can put out this fire and make sure that everybody stays safe.
Opposition is being drummed up.
We can't drink oil, we can't eat the money, but water is very important for us.
A grassroots gathering of protesters saddled up for a spirit ride to preserve tribal water rights.
It will devastate our clean drinking water, which is our primary right, is to have clean drinking water for the future.
This band of demonstrators is riding against the wind. They're traveling dozens of miles through the reservation to the mouth of the Cannonball River. That's the point where the route of the Dakota Access Pipeline is projected to go.
It's crossing under the Missouri River, and we are not happy about that because if anything happened, we would be without water, and water is everything to us.
The trail of resistance doesn't end when the ride is over. A spiritual camp will be set up at the point the pipeline crosses the water.
We have people that are willing to move out there. They're going to set up teepees, live out there for the duration, however long it takes, to bring awareness and hopefully to stop this pipeline.
The Army Corps of Engineers is expected to make a decision on the waterway portion of the project in May. In Fort Yates, Megan Mitchell, NBC, North Dakota News.
Good evening. Members of the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe have been drumming up consistent opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline.
And today in Mobridge, South Dakota, more than 200 protesters met with a representative from the Army Corps of Engineers. Megan Mitchell tells us how it went.
Colonel John Henderson was given a tough assignment today. He faced overwhelming opposition to a pipeline project his agency will evaluate.
If this permit is approved, you would be responsible for an unprovoked act of war against the Oshente Shangoni in violation of our treaties.
Opponents of the Dakota Access Pipeline began public testimony voicing concerns.
My son lays in his grave above that river. And I will take every ounce of my being to protect that.
This section of the pipeline will cross residents' land in Morton and Emmons counties and go underneath the Missouri River in Cannonball. Members of the Standing Rock Reservation cited the community's health issues as well.
We're not just concerned with the water that's actually flowing in the river. We're concerned with our drinking water, our well water, that could become contaminated.
No one spoke in favor of the pipeline.
My two-year-old has no idea what this means for her, but I do, and I have a voice, and I will use it on behalf of her and all of those that cannot speak for themselves.
Legal concerns were also raised.
If the concern is the oil company might get mad if the Corps of Engineers denies the permit, your policy requires the Corps to respect treaty rights. Water rights are treaty rights.
At the end of the public meeting, Colonel Henderson addressed the crowd.
It's our job to ensure that these permits do not have a negative impact and do not damage the environment.
Protesters are running 500 miles to Omaha, Nebraska to deliver the official petition to the Army Corps of Engineers and should arrive early next week. In Mobridge, Megan Mitchell, NBC, North Dakota News.
They're telling everyone if they're on the street, they will be arrested. So everyone right now is staying on the sidewalk. They are not going into the street.
Law and order prevailed at the start of the third day of protests against the Dakota Access Pipeline. Highway patrolmen held the barricade line, standing shoulder to shoulder in front of a group of 50 activists as heavy construction equipment rolled by. The sight and sound of backhoes and bulldozers moving into the construction area had a demoralizing effect on demonstrators.
When the bulldozer was brought in, I really felt violated. You know, as a steward of this earth and as a person that wants a healthy future for my children, I felt violated.
By early afternoon, as more and more protesters showed up, The spirits of the rapidly growing crowd changed as they realized numbers were on their side.
I'm dedicated, so I'll be here to the end.
The arrival of Hollywood actress Shailene Woodley coincided with the shift in activist attitude.
I'm here because even though I'm not from North Dakota, I know that what happens to this Missouri River is going to happen to me eventually. So I need to stand in solidarity with my brothers and sisters to prevent this from happening here, because hopefully one day they'll stand in solidarity with me as well to prevent it from happening in my community.
To maintain peace in the face of overwhelming opposition, Morton County Sheriff Kyle Kirchmeier persuaded construction workers to go home. That action prompted rumors the unearthing of skeletal remains was the reason pipeline crews abruptly left the site. Protesters then stormed gates that had been built the past 2 days and destroyed barricades at the work site.
Please leave!
Hi, things have escalated here today. We've been here since the early morning, and law enforcement has entered this new camp. They have taken down tents and are asking people to move south back to the original protest camp. I'm here with Dallas Goldtooth. So Dallas, tell me, what has the energy been like here today?
Pepper sprayed. They've pepper sprayed, they've used rubber bullets, or beanbag bullets, they've used concussion grenades on a crowd of peaceful water protectors.
Hundreds of protesters waiting anxiously outside a federal courthouse on Wednesday for a decision on whether or not the Dakota Access Pipeline construction will continue. And now they'll have to wait just a little bit longer.
We certainly hope for a ruling today.
Jan Hasselman is an attorney representing the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe, who is suing federal regulators for approving permits for the Dakota Access Pipeline that will move oil from North Dakota to Illinois.
We're very concerned, and the reason for that is the pipeline construction is moving incredibly fast.
Now, the heart of the legal argument here is, did the Army Corps of Engineers properly consult with the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe ahead of the pipeline's construction?
The way the federal government treats Indian country, Native Americans, is disheartening.
Dave Archambeau, chairman of the Standing Rock Sioux, says his tribe was never consulted by the Army Corps before the construction for the pipeline began.
We were never afforded that opportunity to get to protect our lands. They were just taken from us.
The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers denied our request for comment, but in court, attorneys representing them argued that there is no evidence there are historic artifacts in the path of the pipeline. They also argued that they followed proper protocol in consulting with the tribe, something North Dakota Senator John Hoeven agrees with.
You know, if there is some way for the Corps to work to meet the concerns of the tribe, they should certainly do that. But that has been a consultation process.
Judge James E. Boasberg from the U.S. District Court for the District of Columbia says he'll make a final decision on the pipeline on or before September 9th. In Washington, Samantha Jo Roth, NBC North Dakota News.
Opposition to the pipeline has been building since the Army Corps of Engineers granted permits for construction that could impact water quality on the Standing Rock Sioux Reservation. Today, the conflict reached new levels as arrests were made. Access. That's what protesters and construction workers for Dakota Access Pipeline struggled for south of Fort Rice.
Look into the eyes of my child. Look into the eyes of your child. They drink this water too.
Native Americans were separated from workers by dozens of law enforcement officers and temporary fencing. But some demonstrators ignored police barriers.
The protesters I think their biggest concern is they want to make a point and get arrested and cross the lines, or actually force us to arrest them, because that's what they're doing.
Because the main entrance to the pipeline construction site was blocked yesterday, workers began building a new entrance to get to the river.
We're here protecting the land, trying to show presence of this illegal activity that's happening here.
My kids' future is at stake, and I'm trying to honor our treaty rights.
We're slowly destroying, say, Mother Earth. Mother Earth is the one that takes care of us.
A substantial law enforcement presence kept this protest from getting out of hand.
So right now, we're just in peacekeeping. We're not on either side. We just want to make sure that they can do their job, and the protesters can do it peacefully. That's the goal.
Protesters claim hundreds of opponents of the pipeline will be arriving soon.
We're saying no more. This is it. We don't want to be held economic hostages anymore so that they can make money. We want clean air, clean water, clean environment. That's why we're here.
A temporary federal injunction preventing the digging of the pipeline will be heard in Washington, D.C. August 24th. In the meantime, this temporary access road will continue to be built.
It's impossible to have too many cooks in this kitchen. Volunteers staff this food tent working around the clock to feed water protectors at the Sacred Stone Camp.
As soon as we're done doing a meal, we're getting ready for the next meal, cleaning up, you know, making sure everything's ready to go.
Donnell Barlow feels right at home, even though she's thousands of miles away from her kitchen in Washington. No electric stoves here. Meals are prepared over campfires in mass quantities.
So many people come back in the line again, you know, trying to make it fast as possible. Yeah, everybody loves it. And they have different tribes that come and they have their own specialty.
Patricia Glazier is in charge of this food tent and hears compliments all day long about the food she and others prepare.
Wow. The food is delicious. Everyone who's serving it here is really, really, really sweet, really generous with the food.
The food prepared here provides more than just nourishment.
Everything back there is done with love, compassion, and caring. And it gets fed to the people, and that's what they produce, love, compassion, and caring.
The meals are filled with more than just emotion. They're also very tasty, and you can come back for seconds, even dessert, which makes mealtime that much sweeter.
It looks like the police are coming a little bit closer to the protest line. You can see smoke over there. That's from the fire that has started.
Harvest in Morton County is off to a slow start due to unrest brought on by the Dakota Access Pipeline protest. Producers have had to work around protesters and tensions are rising. Cliff Naylor reports.
When Jared Ernst heads out to work his fields, he's carrying an extra piece of equipment.
I've been carrying a sidearm on me everywhere I go. I got a small revolver that I carry. My wife has started carrying. A bunch of the neighbors have started carrying firearms in their vehicles. Some I think there's some that are carrying on them like I am. You just don't know.
Ernst says his decision to arm himself dates back to an incident that occurred when he says Dakota Access Pipeline protesters drove through his alfalfa field to unload a trailer of horses.
When they were here in the field, I had asked them to get off the field. They were on private property and trespassing, and one of the individuals said that it was his native land and that I needed to leave. There was a few come riding up on horseback swinging lariats and kind of makes a guy a little nervous.
Ernst says the confrontation ended without incident, but he's now erring on the side of caution. Cody Hall, the spokesperson for the Red Warrior Camp, says none of the demonstrators are violent.
We don't have weapons, so those that are arming themselves in a way are being fear-mongered by these officials.
Ernst says law enforcement officials were not present the day he encountered protesters.
That's a last measure. First step, if anything happens, call law enforcement. I visited with a couple of deputies this morning, and they said, by all means, carry, protect yourselves. But if there's an altercation or something, call them. And if it escalates to where you're in fear of your life, you know, do what you need to protect yourself.
Paul says anyone who is arming themselves is overreacting.
We're very compassionate, loving people. And that, you know, consists of everybody at the camp.
In addition to carrying weapons, Ernst says area farmers are sending decoy vehicles down county roads before they move combines from field to field to ensure they are not stopped. He says producers also drive heavy equipment home to the yard every night because they fear it will be vandalized if it's left unattended. In Morton County, Cliff Naylor, NBC North Dakota News.
A show of force by authorities hasn't always influenced behaviors, however. Yesterday's protests at a Dakota Action Pipeline construction site south of St. Anthony were described by law enforcement as a riot. Others say the actions of the activists were peaceful. Tonight, we will let you decide. Yesterday, masked protesters confronted our news crew, threatening them with physical violence. The story you're about to see contains strong language that had to be bleeped at times.
It appears at this time to be a pretty volatile situation.
While some would like to say that this was a protest, this was not a protest, this was a riot.
We are here to stop this pipeline by any means necessary.
We said you can come in here.
Our car is over here.
You guys need to go to your car and get the f*** out of here then.
Don't talk to us like that, sir. There's no need to talk to us like that.
I don't care. There's no need to post bullshit. Keep it moving then. Go to your car.
We had situations where people who were there, legitimate media that was there to film it, were being stopped.
Is that a cross path?
We're being questioned as to their credentials.
Put your hand in front of his camera.
Who are they to ask this? They're on somebody else's property.
Man, shut the f*** up. Everybody else, dude. You keep talking, dude, I'm going to beat your ass, bro.
There was a lot of behavior today that took it up a notch.
Can't drink oil.
Keep it in the soil.
I mean, we turn it.
Not a peaceful protest, not a prayerful protest. They say that, but they disguise their criminal behavior.
Ask you to control your emotions.
You guys, tensions are high here. It's probably best just to...
Where are you working for?
You cannot take your ideology and a belief, no matter how strongly you believe in it, and trespass on somebody else's land, use your ideology to break the rule of law, or trample somebody else or another American citizen's rights because you believe your belief is stronger than theirs. That's not how it works in America.
We stand for water!
We don't make the law, we enforce the law. And the courts have spoken. And they have said that the company can work past the 20-mile exclusion.
The whole world is with us protecting the water.
Good evening. Dakota Access has agreed not to drill under the Missouri River while the company and those opposing its pipeline await rulings on some court decisions.
However, construction has continued elsewhere, and today protesters targeted one of those spots. Max Grossfeld is here to tell us what they did. Max?
One site had to shut down for the day after protesters found an effective way to block their work.
Police shut down Highway 6 for several hours as protesters take their fight directly to Dakota Access.
The pipeline is getting too close, and we don't need it that close to where the boundary's at. Enough was enough.
Two people attached themselves to heavy machinery, and another was arrested in the early morning for protesting at a Dakota Access pipeline site south of Mandan.
One of the attached protesters was immediately arrested. Dale American Horse Jr. was stuck so tight in a pipe wrapped with tar and chicken wire, he remained for several hours.
Yeah, this is not a nonviolent action. You know, we came here to disrupt, which we are. We're still in the process.
You have to move 100 yards down to your work area.
Police had to move protesters away from the backhoe. Some refused and were arrested in the process.
This is just another example of the way those in power use police presence and police force to oppress people who, again, are already marginalized and fighting to protect our planet.
Of the 8 arrested, 6 were from out of state.
All these other individuals that don't live here, work here, are going to go home and go to different locations. But we're still here trying to be neighbors and making sure that our relationships are not damaged in this.
American Horse of the Rosebud Sioux Tribe in South Dakota was finally removed from the excavator in the early afternoon.
Feeling pretty sad at the state of North Dakota for defending the oil companies and oppressing the people.
As soon as he was loaded in a police car, work on the Dakota Access Pipeline resumed.
There's probably about 100 anti-DAPL protesters down here right now. There was a small group of pro-DAPL protesters as well.
Authorities arrested 127 Dakota Access Pipeline protesters over the weekend. 71 cases were heard by 3 judges today. Most of the defendants appeared via closed-circuit television. Sarah Berlinger shows us how that made things move faster than usual.
Count 1 is engaging in a riot. To that count, how do you plead, guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
Not guilty, you receive.
This court scenario played out over and over again today in 3 courtrooms equipped with interactive television video systems.
It's new for all of us. We're figuring it out as we go and trying to do the best we can.
Donna Wunderlich is a trial court administrator. She says 3 judges heard 71 pipeline protest cases just today. Aaron Pollitt was one of the water protectors arrested this past weekend.
They blocked our way and then pepper sprayed us and started grabbing people. And As we attempted to retreat, they surrounded us and arrested everyone.
All right, we'll go to the next case then.
Judge James Hill heard cases in one of the courtrooms that had an ITV system.
Going through the judges' schedules, going through courtroom time and availability, because we have more judges than we have available courtrooms. And so scheduling can be somewhat of a trick on an ordinary basis.
Defendants are being held in Morden, Burley, Stark, Cass, McLean, and Mercer counties because there isn't enough room to incarcerate the number of prisoners that have flooded the judicial system.
It will go on as long as it goes on, and we'll just fight through and do what we need to do to manage it.
269 people have been arrested since August 10th in connection with the Dakota Access Pipeline.
We have coverage from both sides of the protest lines, beginning with Sarah Berlinger, who was there as protesters tried to hold on to the new camp they established on private property this week, but were then pushed back to their original camp.
Protesters locked arms and sang songs to defend the land they claim is sacred and rightfully theirs.
There's a ceremony that's taking place behind me here. This is the way that we want to be. We want to be here in prayer and in peace.
The peaceful demonstrations quickly escalated when law enforcement surrounded activists with Humvees, assault vehicles, and more than 150 armed officers in riot gear. The prayers of passionate protesters fell on deaf ears as officers pushed activists back and construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline resumed.
We've been here for months and they're still digging and now they're trenching. And who knows what they're disturbing now, and I just want to run out there by myself. But they keep telling me not to because it's dangerous. There are armed people standing there with their guns, with their finger on the trigger, and so I feel really helpless right now.
Some protesters moved away from the barricade and onto the construction site. Law enforcement has already made arrests.
I come from a long line of defenders. And I just had to be here. I knew I had to come.
Demonstrators tried to stand their ground as officers inched closer to empty the new camp. To slow the process, a group of activists set up a teepee and others attached themselves to a pickup truck on Highway 1806. For NBC North Dakota News, I'm Sarah Berlinger.
The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers has denied the final permit for the Dakota Access Pipeline. The protest camps in southern Morton County have erupted in celebration over the news. Bo Evans was there and has more.
Celebration months in the making. The Dakota Access Pipeline easement to cross the Missouri River has been denied.
We're ecstatic.
Excited.
We jumped up and down, hugged each other. News of the easement's denial came in around 3:30 this afternoon. Since then, cars have been streaming in and out of the camp. People have been celebrating, they've been singing, there's been fireworks, and they've been praying.
Chairman Dave Archambeau thanked those who have joined the movement.
That pipeline had every right to go through, but because of the support that we have, because of the people who gather and are a part of this, we're able to build enough noise to help America understand.
Protesters admit this fight may not be over.
We're slowly getting there, like on winning this thing, but there's going to be a few battles that we're going to have to go through whenever we're going to win this thing too.
But for now, protesters will celebrate their hard-fought victory. Reporting in Cannonball, Bo Evans, NBC North Dakota News.
The Army Corps says it'll do a full environmental impact study in order to consider alternate routes.
Thousands of protesters have been demonstrating since mid-August, saying it's inevitable the Dakota Access Pipeline will leak. Doug Krogos, the Standing Rock Sioux's director of water resources, also has doubts about the safety of a crude oil pipeline water crossing.
Breakage of the pipeline will contaminate our water resources as a whole, the groundwater and the surface water.
Krogos is concerned that even with double-blocked shutoff valves, oil pressure sensors, and other modern technology designed to prevent spills, a catastrophic event could still occur. Modern pipelines are now bored underneath the bed of rivers instead of laying pipe on the river bottom and trenching sand, soil, and rocks over it.
These bores are far safer than the prior technology, which was to trench it. So we think that overall this is an upgrade.
Regulators say the advanced new process makes it far less likely for a rupture to occur.
and these kinds of projects are the best way to transport the crude oil long term.
The State Water Commission did a scour analysis to determine how deep the bore needed to be for the pipe to not impact the water. That number was 24 feet. Dakota Access exceeded that by almost four times the amount, deciding to bore 92 feet below the bottom of the Missouri River.
This project is being designed and built the best that it can be so that it does not threaten North Dakota's number one freshwater source, the Missouri River. That's our yardstick. That's what they have to meet in order to get an authorization, and they did that.
Despite new technology and state-of-the-art safety features, Krogost is still opposed to the project.
It's not worth putting a pipe underneath the Missouri River and thinking that there's possibility of human error.
It's our job to ensure that these permits do not have a negative impact and do not damage the environment.
Even though the pipeline passed the scrutiny of the permitting process and a court challenge was denied, the Army Corps of Engineers recently decided to re-examine the project with another environmental impact study, which means the controversy over the safety of Dakota Access Pipeline will run into 2017. Reporting for NBC North Dakota News, I'm Alyssa Dickert.
Well, protests against construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline began in April and grew in frequency and intensity throughout the year. 577 arrests have been made to date in connection with the demonstrations. Here's a look back at the images and sounds that made the confrontations between activists and law enforcement North Dakota's top news story of 2016.
My two-year-old has no idea what this means for her. But I do.
It's our job to ensure that these permits do not have a negative impact and do not damage the environment.
We're saying no more. This is it.
They do it peacefully. There's no issues and there'll be no arrest.
This is all illegal.
They're violating our treaty rights.
The enemy. They're North Dakotans just like us. That enemy is United States Army Corps of Engineers.
We don't make the law, we enforce the law.
We are here to stop this pipeline by any means necessary.
We're gonna have to keep moving because it's a project that needs to be finished.
There was a lot of behavior today that took it up a notch.
Keep moving south. Keep moving to the south on the road.
We were very compassionate, loving people.
We take an oath to serve and protect.
You cannot take your ideology and a belief, no matter how strongly you believe in it, and trespass on somebody else's land, use your ideology to break the rule of law, or trample somebody else or another American citizen's rights because you believe your belief is stronger than theirs. That's not how it works in America.
Today it's a victory. Today it's a good time to celebrate, you know?
The 1,160-mile-long Dakota Access Pipeline is designed to transport 500,000 barrels of Bakken crude a day to markets on the Gulf Coast and East Coast.